Warning. The following podcast may contain mature material unsuitable for children and young adults, spoilers, and bad opinions, excluding my own. Please enjoy. Welcome to Anime Abroad Podcast. I'm your host today. My name is Kyle, and I'm joined by Corey and Jared.
Hello.
Hello. I forgot we do it different now. The old awkward days when we would just say, we'd be called out and say hello all by ourselves.
Yeah. Let's see. Today is our end of season for fall episode where we analyze each anime and grade them on the scale. And before we start, I've got question of the week. What is your most essential piece of tech that you use every day that isn't a cell phone or computer? Those are basic rights.
Oh boy.
I think I'm cheating a bit from Lion, because I'm using the portable charger for my phone. so I can use my phone.
That's fair.
Yeah. That's fair enough.
Yeah, because like my phone battery dies relatively quickly because I use it a lot. So having my charger around is really fucking helpful. Without it, I'd probably just die at work. I don't know.
Is it solar powered or anything, or is it just a battery pack?
It's just a battery pack. I wasn't sure. How you say that in English. But yeah.
Yeah, you get different ones.
It's really good. Mm-hmm. Has a really long runtime as well and everything. So,
yeah,
I always bring a battery pack with me wherever I go, just in case.
I would, but I don't go anywhere.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Well, what about you, Jared?
I really wasn't sure to start with. I kind of looked around my desk and thought, what's most useful? But I think it'd probably be my headphones, actually.
Oh, that's a good point, actually. Fuck.
Are they portable, or are you talking, are they a headset?
Oh no, it's, I guess, a headset, but not with a mic. Just headphones rather than earphones.
Because I have
good quality stuff.
I guess it used
What brand are they?
Pardon?
What brand are they?
Audio Technica.
Oh nice.
ATH M50s.
Ooh.
Yeah, for me, it used to be my earphones, because like I don't like headphones a lot, because at some point they start hurting me. So
I think my skull might have changed shape slightly, but other than that, it's fine.
Yeah, I've been using the good old Logitech G930s for a couple of years now.
Oh, nice. Yeah, Logitech is great. I'm a big fan.
Yeah, they're pretty decent.
I mean, I haven't had much experience with headsets, but...
Yeah,
I other stuff
that's,
is fantastic.
That's same for me. I think my next upgrade is going to be like a nice pair of headsets without a mic, and I'll just put a mad mic on it.
Yeah, that's pretty.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I've done now. Like, I have the Yeti, of course, for my microphone.
Oh yeah.
So I really just need earphones. I really don't like headphones as a whole, because at some point they start hurting me. Usually just go with earphones, and I guess up until like I lost them in the metro recently. My earphones would have probably been like my most precious thing.
The problem with me for earphones is I really hate the like in-ear ones, IEMs.
Mm-hmm.
Actually use the Apple ones from like the free ones that my mom gets with her phones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just use
those.
I don't like those. Oof. That's the thing. I really like in-ears as a whole.
Like have you ever had a really nice pair of IEMs?
No, because I hate putting them in.
Yeah,
because I use I I used to have Sennheiser ones for a very, very long time, and Sennheiser's really good.
Nice. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I've got like a really nice pair of Shure IEMs.
Mm.
Like they're the kind that like have a detachable cable from them.
Yeah.
Like just
to me, it's
super nice.
To me, it's just kind of like the most comfortable way to enjoy music and everything else. And like yeah, also like, the way I get the some like really good sound as well, I guess. Because like
yeah. There's always a lot of pros and cons, I feel, for in-ear monitors.
Yeah.
Because like mine are like super high quality, and they bring a really balanced sound scale to where like, you know, nothing is overpowering. It's a really flat EQ, but like not an unimpressive EQ. It's really clean.
Yeah.
But they're uncomfortable for wearing more than like an hour and a half, 2 hours.
Oh, okay.
Whereas like my headset is super fucking comfortable. I can wear it as long as I want. But like the audio is not bad, but it's just not as clean as my in-ear monitors. Because I'll wear those when I'm like doing piano or something like that.
For me, it's just like my headset that I used to have at home was like it had good sound, pretty decent, but it would at some point start hurting my head, and like really didn't like that. And for like the in-ears I got later on were just like for once generally really comfortable. They're like at the point where at some point I don't even realize I'm still wearing in-ears or something, you know. but yeah, and the sound was way better as well, so I just kind of stuck with that.
Right on. Well, Jonas took my tech of the day, so I'll have to do a little switcheroo.
Piano.
I feel like that's a basic right for me, though.
Okay.
I'll say I can't really take that around. I'll switch and say my Bluetooth speaker.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a good one as well. I love my Bluetooth speakers.
Yeah, I would like.
Yeah, because I use that a ton every day. Like when I take a shower, I bring it with me, just sit it there and play music in the shower. Or like when I go to sleep, I just have it there, laying next to me.
Yeah,
playing music.
Obviously that's somewhat difficult for me now because like I live with so many people. But like I used to be 100% the same at home. So.
Yeah, like it's a cheap one. It's, you know, it's probably like 30, 40 bucks.
But oh, okay.
It's loud enough and it gets the job done.
Yeah, I have like I got mine like I think 2 years ago or something for my birthday. So and like it's a really good one. Like it's a Bose one. I'm not sure how popular Bose is outside of Germany.
They're pretty popular.
Yeah, but so they're pretty good. And like I've had them for like the past 2 years and they're still doing their job super good, so I'm really happy.
Nice.
German engineering.
Well, I guess that wraps up the question of the week. Let's get right into it, boys.
Today's the day. It's finally come.
Okay.
Did we actually make a list of when we do what show? I don't think we did we?
Any show?
No, we didn't. We'll go through it quickly on whether we watched it. Or care to actually grade it.
Alright.
Oh, I'm looking forward.
Let's go to the
first
shop.
Up, we've got 12 Sai Chichana Namune no Tokimeki 2, season 2.
No.
Yeah, I watched the first season, not completely. Next up.
Like two episodes.
Next up, Zangatsu no Lion.
We can skip that, because it's not finished.
We can skip that, it's not finished yet.
Okay. Yeah, I dropped it already anyways.
Yeah.
How could it's a good you? Show.
It's boring, man.
It's the fucking
it's
best.
It's not his kind of thing.
It's not, yeah, it's not my kind of thing.
Yeah, I guess.
Ajin 2. No one watched that.
What's season 1?
All out. Let's do it.
Okay. Can I start?
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
I dropped All Out because it wasn't that I thought it was bad, but I thought, why don't I just go continue watching Haikyuu?
Yeah, that was kind of why I did what I was like. I watched, Honestly, I already dropped it after episode one.
I was tempted to, because episode one is really boring.
Yeah, I just really didn't see any appeal in it at all. Is it actually done yet? I know it's not done, but
too cool.
Yeah, it's too cool. But it just really, I didn't feel like it had any appeal into it whatsoever. That was like specific to All Out.
I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah, it's just,
it didn't have much of a personality.
Yeah, it felt so incredibly just
underwhelming.
Standard, and yeah, underwhelming is probably the best word to say. Because I know a lot of people were really excited for this one, and like just kind of never really did anything with it.
It felt like a really clockwork sports anime. You know, cutout template. This is what you do for a sports anime.
Yeah, pretty standard.
I had a slight intention of finishing it, but mm-hmm. just kind of got lost in the torrent of all the other bad anime.
Yeah.
Let's see. I think it's about it for that.
Yeah.
Are we still doing the 3 hours?
No, we haven't finished it, so we're not doing 3 hours, right?
All right. Okay. Blood of Wars.
I don't think anyone. No. Brave Witches.
I have a little bit to say on this.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Alright, I didn't finish it. I was 3 or 4 episodes into it, but I don't feel like it has the same soul as the original Soul Witches anime.
Strike. Because
when I watch, did I say Soul Witches?
Yes, you did.
Oh my god.
You did just wake up like half an hour ago.
Yeah, it's 3:07 in the morning. Alright. So, yeah, it doesn't have the same soul as Strike Witches, and that, like, I don't get my constant panty shots in fan service, which is what people expect from an anime like the Witches series. Like no one watches Brave Witches or Soul Witch. No one watches Brave Witches or Strike Witches to see how humanity fights off the alien incursion. No one cares about that. It's all about the panties and the boobs. And there was actually no boobs in Brave Witches, which... What? Well, as far as I watched, there was no boobs or sign of censored boobs in Brave Witches. I do intend to finish it eventually, but I just wanted to say for the first 3 or 4 episodes, it did not live up to its original title.
All right, but we can rank it. I think we can open, right? No. I watched a bit of the first season. I just want to say that I really actually quite like the first. I actually quite like the Bookkeeper Ranky. It has a lot of visual identity to it, but I've never continued as far to watch second season. So yeah, I want to watch more.
Bookkeeper Ranky was a success in my mind only in the first episode.
We loved the first episode.
I really think that like the first 4 episodes or so, at least I've seen like 6 or so, and in the first 4 episodes or so were really strong in my opinion. Especially, I think it has a lot of, like, there's some weaknesses to it, but I think it has visually it is a very strong show. Not necessarily in the sense of like the CGI, but like the framing and what the show does.
Yeah, I do remember
with
being quite impressed by that first couple.
Yeah, because like it's directed by someone that has a lot to do with Trigger. And it's a very Gainax-ish show, I guess, in a way, from how it looks. So yeah.
Okay, it's been a while, but I do plan to finish it after.
Same.
I think what turned my group off to it more was like the fact they had such a nice concept for the first episode, and then
it completely,
I feel like,
changed.
It became just completely contrived after they jumped off the island. Like, you know, animation and framing aside, like, I hated all the characters.
Oh, the characters.
As soon as, like, I was introduced to all the new characters, I was just like, man, these schmucks are all the same cookie cutter stereotypes.
I could get over with it changing.
Yeah, I think it
gets better. I didn't like
better.
The characters.
Yeah,
I've heard of those.
I think it does get better over time, but, I
do plan to finish it.
Yeah, I will likely finish it, but I'm not sure when.
Yeah, same.
So yeah, we'll see. I think we can move on then to Bungo Stray Dogs second season.
It's time.
Bungo Stray Dogs.
I haven't finished it yet. I haven't finished it yet, but the first arc was incredible. Fucking loved it.
It's incredible. That's like the perfect word for it.
It's the perfect arc takes exactly what I loved about the first season and takes it further. It takes the things that made the first season to me really stand out, and it kind of pushes them into a direction that I personally really enjoy. Like, the serious parts of Bungo Stray Dogs have always been like my favorite things, because I think that it really excels at them, especially when when Igarashi takes up like the storyboarding, and that has made for my favorite parts in the first season. And the first arc in the second season is purely that, and it's even better than anything the first season did. So,
fucking loved it. I actually also think that any comedy that was in those four episodes was also very well implemented.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Because it didn't.
I would say the comedy was an improvement by having as much comedy.
Yeah, I think the first the contrast is kind of that in the first season, it was a lot of comedy complemented by the show getting more serious, while the second season was at least for the first few episodes I've seen, was a very serious show that was complemented by some of its comedy, like some of its more lighter parts that helped characterizing the entire thing.
I think it added to the tone rather than where I felt quite a lot of it in the first season was a bit distracting.
Very distracting.
I did enjoy it a lot of the time, but it could be quite distracting sometimes.
My biggest problem for this first season was
interrupting.
With all these great serious scenes that are then completely trivialized by some kind of nonsensical comedy that just happens immediately afterwards.
The thing is,
like you had like the first episode 3 where MC gets his shit fucked up by Tentacle Dude. And then afterwards it's like, oh, he like immediately killed two of his friends. And then the next episode is like, oh no, everyone's fine.
Yeah, it's kind of
one. You know, that nearly just didn't happen right there.
It's kind of like, I always thought that the comedy for Bungo Stray Dogs itself was very good. I actually really enjoy the comedy on its own. The problem that Bungo Stray Dogs to me always had was its tone. Just maintaining its tone was always the problem that Bungo Stray Dogs had for me. And that inconsistency kind of made season one a lot less enjoyable. Whereas season two is a lot more consistent with that from what I've seen, at least. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think even after those four episodes, it became a lot more similar to the first season. It became very similar. But I think it did improve, generally.
Okay.
In its tone.
That makes me happy.
Especially going up to the climax.
Looking at Bungo Stray Dogs takes me back to like the days of like where a lot of action shonens were of a decent quality coming out, and well, because it combines like the two traits of a shonen action that matter the most. You know, you've got comedy and action. I'm not in that demographic anymore. Like the kind of comedy that Bungo has, like it's not for me. But from what I can tell, it did really well for its demograph.
Mm-hmm.
If you know what I mean.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Did you guys finish it?
Yeah. Well, I did.
I've got just a few episodes left.
All right, Jared, 3 Austin.
I rated it a 7. And to give some context to that, I rated the first season a 6. I would unlikely rewatch it. However, I would recommend it. Not a high priority, but I think there are specific things that stand out about it that you could like spot out that someone might like, someone specific.
Yeah,
like the comedy, for example, or even just the plot.
Yeah, I think like
for
if you like
for younger teenagers, it's perfect.
I think if you enjoy this kind of story in general, I think Don't Go Straight Out is a relatively solid pick. And I think it also is also worth watching. Honestly, I almost recommend watching the first four episodes of the second season as a standalone as an introduction to the series. As well. It's very accessible for like you don't really need to know anything that's happening before. So if you're not interested in Bungo Stray Dogs, I highly recommend you watch the first four episodes of season two.
Even if you're not going to watch any more of the series after that, those four episodes are fantastic. Honestly. Mm-hmm.
Just keep in mind the season, the show as a whole is generally relatively different from those four episodes.
Yeah.
Don't go into the show afterwards and believe that you're going to get the same thing again. Sadly,
the plot is definitely related.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Still slightly more serious.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But yeah.
All right, then.
Pretty good.
Card Fred Banger G next. I don't think anyone watched that, right?
Well, you haven't given your 3 hours.
I haven't finished the show.
You didn't finish it.
Oh, you haven't? All right.
I've only seen four episodes.
Skipping Card Fight, and no one's seen it. Does anyone have anything about a Classicaloid?
Nope.
Not really. I've only seen two or three episodes.
I just want to say I like classical music. I didn't finish Classicaloid because it has classical music. Because it's not, it wasn't. Yeah.
Yeah.
Next up, we've got Drifters.
Okay. I dropped Drifters because I was incredibly bored.
I never tried it.
To be honest, it's not your kind of show.
Yeah, I forget. So I just just completely ignored it.
Yeah, I'm a little bit too old for that kind of demographic. Like, you know, blood, gore, and action is, you know, my kind of thing, but not like that.
I liked the kind of God versus God kind of thing they had going on. I like that stuff, but it wasn't enough to keep me watching. It was a drag to go through.
I feel like
it gets better after the four or so episodes I watched, but I honestly don't even want to give it the time.
I've generally heard surprisingly good things about it. Considering my expectations for it were near zero, really. But I still don't believe that it's something that is very much worth my time right now.
I don't think so.
I do want to finish it out of a general respect for the original author. Mm-hmm. You know, like Helsing was one of the earlier anime I watched. The original Helsing.
Yeah.
Let's see. I feel like it's kind of a cop-out because two of the best series last season are next up. Might as well just get into them. Flip Flappers.
Okay, let's get this.
Studio 3 Hertz, thank you.
Bless Oshiyama. He's the fucking best.
Oshiyama is a cool dude.
Oh man, he's so good. Yeah, Flip Flappers is a very important show.
Like, before I even get into everything I like about Flip Flappers, I want to talk about the things I don't like.
Okay. You always like to do get the bad out of the way.
Yeah. All right. Well, I feel like the overall quality of the show went in a very slight downward curve.
Do you mean as an animation?
Production or...
I mean, let's see. Like, story. Not
everything.
Not just, like, pretty much everything.
Okay.
Like, it just kind of the enjoyment I got slowly was in a downward curve going near the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I really just enjoyed that episodic nature it held for the first half of the show.
I think I've realized that this, like, over the past year or something, but episodic nature is something I've really, really enjoy in shows. It gives kind of like, it kind of gives space for people to kind of explore things in different situations. And I think that is.
Yeah, it gives the creator a chance to, like, create multiple feelings in the show, multiple areas.
Facets. Yeah, exactly. Pretty
much. Multiple ambiances, I'll say, to be fancy. And that was the best part of Flip Flappers for me, was like watching these two girls like jump into different worlds, mm-hmm. explore different feelings, and then also
learn a bit more about themselves.
Just the complete change of tone every episode had was the best part of Flip Flappers for me. Like, I mean, yeah. Okay, the animation for the first half was like really good. Not only that, but just like
it's the art. It's the whole art direction.
It's the art direction is gorgeous.
Like color direction as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just everything fit the theme of of each episode perfectly per episode. And
beautiful backgrounds.
Yeah, it was just wonderful all around. Mm-hmm. And then you've got the character designs, which are so nice.
Yeah. Oh, it's like whenever I first saw the character designs for Flip Flappers, I was actually really turned off by it.
Yeah,
like, I think when they're not in motion, the character designs for Flip Flappers look absolutely awful, honestly. I think that when they're in motion especially, they're absolutely gorgeous. And I've actually gotten to the point where I'm used to them, and I've actually really taken a liking to them, even if I don't see them in motion. So,
yeah.
It's, for me personally, Flip Flappers is not a show I adore, honestly. It's a show I respect a shit ton because of what it does. It's actually, to me, maybe even comparable to something like Utena, where...
Yeah, okay. I see.
I don't have a personal connection to Flip Flappers. I don't have one that is incredibly deep. But what it does is something I love for shows to do, and I think it is, and I have an incredible amount of respect for what went into that show. So, yeah.
I feel the same way. Like, just to get off, like, what was your guys' favorite world?
The one that I remember most is, I think it's episode 5 or 6 in the school. It's the kind of horror.
That was the first one that came to mind for me as well. The school, like, the three that come to mind for me are the school, the grandmother.
Yes, absolutely.
And the desert.
Mad Max, yeah.
Yeah. It was
same three for me.
Yeah.
I was thinking during the show, like, this is definitely a Mad Max reference, this whole episode. Oh, yeah, and then like it was basically confirmed there was a movie poster at the end or near the end.
Yeah. in Kokona's room, I think.
Right.
It's funny. Mm.
It's so cool. It's
a hard pick for me between the Mad Max episode and the horror.
Mm.
It's just, I'm a massive fan of Space Dandy, and this at times gave off very similar vibes.
Yeah. Oshiyama did do his Space Dandy episode, didn't he?
He did a great Space Dandy episode.
Yeah. I don't think I've actually seen the Space Dandy episode yet, so...
It's really going to take a probably watch on its own.
I think I like the action in the Mad Max episode the best, and then I like the ambiance in the horror episode the best.
I think what stuck with me for the Mad Max episode especially was I think that was kind of when, to me, like the entire goal of Flip Flappers kind of became more clear.
Yeah.
Because like that's really where the show gets into like the nitty gritty of what it wants to do.
It's episode 3.
And yeah, episode 3, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
In retrospect, it's obvious before that, but episode 3, like, kind of confirmed everything, I guess, in a way. And that's kind of why I really like it. I think my first personal favorite has to be the girl school, though, because that one's really good.
Yeah, I want to rewatch even just that episode.
Yeah. Yeah, I really have much more to say about Flip Flappers. Like, I feel like everything about Flip Flappers has been said to so much extent by now on other blogs and everything. It's an amazing show that does a lot of amazing things with its characters and its thematic work. I still feel blessed that we have like something like Flip Flappers and Yuri on Ice and all those and those kind of things like within one season. Ping Pong Girls isn't really. Ping Pong Girls is a bit different.
Only a little bit,
but like in terms of their thematic structure, I guess something like Flip Flappers and Yuri on Ice one season is really good.
Also, to mention, like the OP and Edie were just on point.
They were fantastic.
Do you know how long I had flip flop and stuck in my head?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I had that too.
I've got it blaring in my car most days.
That sounds like a weird song to blare.
Yeah.
Well, I like my journey into town to be an adventure. if not to just drown out the monotonous drive of daily life. Yeah, pretty much.
Like Papika.
And then, like, I feel like we've never talked about the actual, like,
plot.
The queer undertones.
Oh.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's what I mean, basically, with the thematic work.
It's like, yeah, there were queer undertones, but it was not the major focus.
I think it's a lot of what it does in its thematic work. The show obviously never goes into, like, a canon relationship, but I don't think it needs to.
Yeah.
I think it's just exploring one of my favorite
favorite people, like, on Twitter has been talking about flip-floppers forever. And she, I mean, I think you know what I'm talking about.
Exactly.
It's kind of hard to miss when you follow her. But she's written a piece on it for Crunchyroll, and kind of like, where she also talks a lot about, like, the power of,
I think me and Jared both read that article. Called.
Yeah.
I forgot what it's called. Power of, I'm bad with words right now.
I'm trying to think what you mean.
Fucking hell.
Well, restart your sentence.
The power of diversity.
Oh, no, that's not diversity. I don't think flip-floppers has much to do with diversity, to be honest. Undertones is the word. The power of undertones in the show. And I think that flip-floppers is a good example for that, really. Because what it wants to achieve is not necessarily, like, it doesn't want to achieve a diversity in its show. It's fine not confirming that that his characters are in fact gay, but it's in its undertones, it very much presents that, and it very much presents how especially Kokona realizes herself, how she gets to know herself and everything, how, like, this, how she discovers that in undertones, through the undertones, how she discovers that she is in fact queer. And I think that's a really important thing already. And I think that flip-floppers didn't canonically make them gay is not a bad thing. I think that the way flip-floppers handle it is very much fine.
Yeah.
I feel like
quite a nice and almost refreshing way to do it as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's like, not often that almost the main focus is not thrown right at you constantly.
Well, I felt like it was, you get a bit of a taste of it each episode.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like a different taste of it each episode. Mm-hmm. But then, like, the only con I had about it was that, like, I feel like that aspect of the show kind of took a backseat near the end. Mm. Like when they were like, all right, now we have to actually, you know, finish the plot.
Do you mean like the queer aspect or the
aspect?
Yeah. I don't think so. I think that's actually like where it all comes together, because like it's as I said, it's not about queer in terms of they have to get together, but I think it's about queer in terms of finding yourself, finding out that you're queer, etc. And I think that really comes to fruition towards the end of the season. Granted, I actually enjoyed the first half more as well. But I think where the thematic work comes to fruition is like the last bit. So yeah.
Is that flip flappers?
Sorry?
Yeah.
I think what I just wanted to say
is, I do think you're right. But
yeah.
I'm trying to.
What I also just wanted to say is like why that, I think that comparison to something with Tenor, which is obviously like a really high comparison, but
yeah.
The comparison to Utena, I think, stands in the sense as well as what you just said, that it doesn't outright throw its themes at you, but it, like, the themes, they're very underlying.
There.
Yeah, exactly. But Utena is hailed at like the most one of the most progressive things that ever came out of anime, and it never confirms anything queer outside of its movie. I think a movie does. I'm not sure. I haven't seen it yet.
Okay.
While I don't know, there was one. But it's Tenna as well, does its thematic work a lot in its undertones and a lot in that kind of way. And I think that's why, that's also a big, big, big reason why it's so popular. And I think Flip-Flappers is kind of the same. And that's why I'm glad Flip-Flappers exists. It's a really good show.
I've never thought about that in the Utena before.
Mm.
I haven't watched a lot of it, but yeah.
Yeah, I have
that's
to
a good, that's a good
it.
Comparison.
Yeah, I feel like I feel like I've missed so much in Utena.
Yeah,
it's like
you always will.
Utena has, like, I'm comparing the two, but I still feel like Utena has infinitely more layers to it than Flip-Flappers.
Oh, yeah.
Utena, like, Utena was just at times painfully cryptic about its undertones.
I can see that. It's a very, 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 very cryptic show. Yeah. Do we do 3 hours then?
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm going to go up first. Just, I've rated it a 9 out of 10. Because, yeah, the reasons I explained. I would absolutely recommend it to pretty much everyone. As long as you're somewhat interested in the themes it presents. And or enjoy...
Or the episodic nature.
Like, it's just generally really colourful worlds and fun stuff it does.
If you like action, and if you like Alice in Wonderland action...
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's more accurate.
Also, if you like good animation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You should probably watch
the show. If you like good anime.
Yeah, if you like good anime, you should maybe watch Flip-Flappers.
Yeah.
It's a good show. Also, a rewatch... I'm honestly unsure so far. I can't promise I will rewatch it, but maybe.
Fair enough. I'll go next. Yeah. I still don't know if I'm going to peg it at an 8 or 9 after all this time. Like, I feel like just to choose one now, I'll give an 8.5. Recommending it, yeah. I feel like there are some people that wouldn't appreciate it as much, only because, like one of my best friends probably would not like this because it's probably a little bit too girlish for him. But, like, that's fair enough.
Yeah, absolutely.
But for most other people, yeah, I definitely recommend this. Rewatch, yeah. I feel like when the Blu-rays come out, I want to check them out and see what's changed, and, you know, get that better quality next.
Yeah.
And can you imagine Flip-Flap is looking even better than it does already?
Slightly.
Or just to rewatch the OP.
I was actually in a similar situation. I was kind of hovering between an 8 and a 9, but I eventually did choose the 9. I'm really not sure about rewatching, possibly individual episodes.
I feel like
maybe eventually.
I feel like it doesn't really feel like the show you rewatch a lot, to be honest, for some reason.
Yeah. It was a good experience, but. Yeah, I don't think I need to add anything to the recommendations. Other than yes.
Up next is Fune wo Amu. Good shit.
Good shit. I'm doing the hand motion.
I don't really have too much to say about it.
I do.
It's a good anime. I remember the first time we saw the first episode, I don't think many of us in my group, at least, were very impressed.
No, the thing is, I was looking forward to it because it was an interesting premise. Simply because of the dictionaries. That's unusual, to say the least.
I thought I was under the impression you were about ready to give up on it.
No, before it started, I was hopeful. And then when we watched episode 1, there were quite a few things that stood out to me as being pretty good, but it didn't really engage me because I think mostly because of how they kind of introduced the plot almost. Kyle know what I'm talking about. How he got the job, it felt not at all natural.
Yeah, it was very, it was quite contrived.
Yeah, I don't like using that word, but I think it's actually appropriate. But after that first episode, it was actually very natural. Strangely natural. Yeah,
I don't think they could have set it up a really much of a better way.
No,
because there's no way they could naturally make MC just be like, "Oh, I think I'll switch departments to writing dictionaries."
I mean, there's got to be some way, but
without him just being scouted in a inspirational manner.
Yeah. But yeah, Funoamu is a very natural show. It's very down to earth. Very human, actually.
Yeah, like being that it was, I don't know if it was originally adapted from the live drama, but
I believe a novel.
Yeah. I don't know where the anime got most of its hints from. It probably got a lot of them from the live-action drama.
It feels like a novel, though. It feels like literature, almost.
I don't know. It felt like one of the live-action.
It's about a dictionary, after all.
Yeah. And throughout the show, there was a lot of the character interactions were some of the best parts of the show. Like you said, it was all very natural, but like entertaining. And as soon as like they introduced, a level of complexity to it, where, oh hey, there's a girl in his apartment, I was just like, yeah, I'm gonna like this shit.
Yeah, I think that like took the rating up a bit for you.
Yeah,
it took the enjoyment up.
Other than that. Good drama. The ending, it got me. Felt good. It's one of those kind of feel good Hallmark movies.
I actually want to go back to the natural thing because it really stood out to me. It feels. I almost never say this. But it almost feels realistic.
Oh yeah.
Just
yeah, they spend a great time making all so, the characters feel natural. Not just in the way even, it looks, even but jokes, like the
jokes feel perfectly fitting and natural and things people would actually say.
I think a lot of the natural comes out from the fact that these characters were really structured to be realistic as realistic as possible. There's none of that really stereotypical anime personalities in it at all. Yeah. I mean, I believe the most stereotypical anime personality in it was MC's best friend.
Nishioka.
Yeah.
Who's great. But yeah, I said it's like literature. That's because, as 11 episode shows actually quite often are, it's very concise. It's very focused on what it wants to do. It doesn't waste any time sidetracking. It focuses on its themes, and it's what the author wants to say. It feels very genuine and human. It also has a very nice message about the circle of life and being complete or finished in life, and if you're unsatisfied, that's how it is. And it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Because you pave the way for the future, which is nice and optimistic. But yeah, it's a very relaxing show, and I highly recommend it. So I'm just going to go into my 3 R's if Kyle's ready.
Go for it.
Okay, I gave it a 9. Quite possibly rewatch it. Not for a while, but very possibly. And absolutely recommend it to quite a wide demographic.
Okay. As for me, let's see. Again, like, I have a hard time, like, picking an 8 or a 9 for this, so I'll just deign to my 8.5.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I'd recommend it to, like, most people who like things. No, like, if you hate life, then I probably don't recommend this for you. Yeah, especially if you hate life. Especially if you hate life and like normal people.
Yeah.
You're probably not gonna like this very much. Rewatch? Maybe. It'll be a long time down the road.
Good show. Yeah. Anyway. Next. Girlish Number. You've seen this, haven't you?
I've seen an episode or two of it. Actually.
You haven't finished it?
I've only finished like 3 or 4 shows this season, so. Most of the things I'm going to talk about I've barely watched. I'm just going to bullshit my way through this podcast.
That's fine.
Fair enough. I mean, I haven't finished Girlish Number either. I'm pretty much halfway through.
Okay, yeah, that should be interesting then.
I dropped it halfway, I dropped it after 2 episodes because, I don't like it. It's style of humor, I guess. It's really just a very personal thing where I don't have... I don't enjoy cynical things a whole lot, let's say it that way. And Girlish Number is the definition of cynical. It's a very negative take on it, on the entire industry, I guess, from what I've seen.
Yeah.
And that is not something I enjoy a whole lot. It's...
The thing is, I do quite like cynicism sometimes, but this felt slanderous.
Yeah.
So, for the first few episodes, I did have a problem with that. I didn't hate the show, but I was a bit...
Yeah, apathetic. I don't hate it. I'm far from hating it, honestly. It's I actually did have quite a bit of fun of watching it, but it was always this, like... nagging feeling, I guess, in the back of my mind. Yeah. I was just like, I don't want it to be this cynical. Can we be a bit more positive, please? That's kind of not what I want the show to be. And at some point, that just kind of grew relatively overbearing that I just kind of didn't want to watch any more of it and just dropped it.
Yeah.
Yeah, for me, I felt like it just couldn't take itself seriously. Like you said, the innate nature of the show...
I kind of felt similarly to begin with.
It's hard to really put it in words, but I never got the feeling that the show was really about much of anything for the most part, other than showing how this girl is just kind of a piece of shit. Which she is like, cannot deny this girl is quite naturally a piece of shit.
Yeah,
kind of.
To begin with, I didn't see much in it either. Sorry.
Because, like, for me, I could care less about, you know, what kind of development happens to her in the end. Like, oh, I become, like, if she, I would, it would be an even more cop-out to me if she changed at the end and was, like, you know... became somewhat of a decent human being, but like, no, I don't care. Like, throughout the show, all I wanted was to see this girl suffer. I wanted to see her just completely fail. I would like to see her become some... Yeah, I'm not going to say that, but...
yeah, don't say it.
I wanted nothing more than to see her suffer through the entire show. Something... I want to... Yeah. Instead of like... from the ground up rise to being a decent human being, I wanted to see her like rise up to fame only to like fall to the pit bottom.
For me, it's kind of like, honestly, I'm interested in Girlish Number still. I still am interested in like picking it up again and watching more of it, but it's really this little part of the show that's kind of keeping me back from it. I want to know what happens later on. I want to see what I want to see. I'm actually interested in these characters. I'm invested in some of them. But, like, it's just, like, this really relatively small part of the show, I guess, that's really bothering me a lot, and that really is keeping me from enjoying it as much as I think I would otherwise, and that's the main thing that annoys me about the show.
Yeah, early on, I felt that kind of the dumbness almost went a bit too far.
Yeah.
And that kind of made it feel a bit fake to me and ingenuine.
Yeah.
However, after about halfway, it really started to become slowly more interesting to me.
Okay.
It started focusing more on the seiyuu, the voice actors,
mm-hmm.
and their individual problems related to both the industry and, I guess, to their family.
Which honestly sounds way more interesting to me.
Yeah, it was.
Because, like, the main things that really bothered me were generally connected to people like the light novel author that's kind of, like, portrayed as this absolute fucking loser.
Yeah.
The producer that's kind of just portrayed as this absolute fucking asshole. I mean, that's where my main problems lie. I'm actually interested in the voice actresses themselves. It's just, like, everything else around it was very...
And then you have the biggest cuck. You have the biggest cuck of the entire show. MC's big brother.
I hate that so much.
Oh.
I haven't seen my brother, actually.
Well, no, he's just the guy. Episode. He's
her manager.
Yeah, he's her manager.
Oh, that's him.
And, like, he literally just pretty much does whatever she wants for the most part. And it got really annoying. Because, I mean, like, I was like, all right, you know, here's a guy I can relate with. He doesn't like her. But then it became very clear that, like, he's literally a placeholder in the series to add, you know, I don't want to say actually, a self-insert element.
No, he used to be a voice actor, and they use that to some effect.
Well, that's something they should reveal, you know, towards the beginning.
I think they did, actually. I think I just forgot. But the show, yeah, it gradually got more and more interesting. It wasn't just the voice actors, even. By the end, I actually didn't hate anybody, which is amazing.
Yeah, that's kind of like where I wanted the show to go for, like these aren't perfect people. Of course they aren't, because no one's perfect. But like to portray them as like people that still function in a way. And not as some kind of asshole, but just as people. But from what I've seen, it just kind of really didn't seem to want to do that. And that's why I dropped it. So, like, hearing what you say about it now, I'm actually a lot more interested in picking it up again. If I will, I'm not sure. But
yeah.
I'm definitely interested.
It becomes a lot more personal. Eventually, people stop giving Chitose so much of a chance. Because constantly she's not that good, so they give her a bit more time just to grow. But eventually they get kind of sick and tired of that, and that's what starts to spur it for her specifically. And by the end, it was actually surprisingly optimistic. It was...
Cop out.
No, it was very, I don't say natural again, but it felt very organic. It was, they also used the light novel author, how they were kind of shitting on him earlier on. Him and Chitose, it was kind of, I know that anybody could replace me, but this is where I want to be. This is what I want to be doing. So I'm going to work for it. I want
to
stay
here.
That
makes me really happy to hear. That makes me really, really, really happy to be honest.
I guess
you've just convinced me to continue watching that show. Just kind of force myself to
the
first
I did like it.
I don't think I could.
As I said.
No, I don't think you should probably finish it, Kyle.
No. I don't think I could ever really appreciate Girlish Number because it's...
Yeah, you don't seem like
it. It's a borderline moe shit for me.
Wow.
I've seen a lot of stuff, and like nowadays it's just kind of it's kind of old. It gets really old. Like I think the thing I hated about the show the most was just like how they tried to be original yet like having these same damn archetype characters.
Yeah, they did get better. They weren't incredible, but they got better.
To point out the worst character in the show is that stupid, the dumb character.
The short one.
Yeah, her. Truly the worst, because she is she's a cookie cutter stereotype from every that show.
Okay. I think we've said enough about Girlish Number.
Yeah.
Bad and good. Both very fair.
What's your 3 hours then?
Oh yeah. I think in the end I'd actually rate it a 7, which I did not expect at all. Recommends? I would recommend it to you, Jonas. I would recommend it. I'm not entirely sure who to, but I think in general it's a fairly solid show.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if you do like the humor at the beginning. That's a big bonus. Because a lot of people did enjoy that. Rewatch? Probably not. I think I got all I would get out of it.
Alright. I'll probably watch it at some point. So yeah, you've just convinced me pretty much.
Yeah.
To give it another chance.
Well, all right. I'm glad our podcast is working.
Okay. Do you want to say something about Haikyuu?
Right, Haikyuu's fucking great. To start with, when I was watching season 2, which I did in over 2 days with my friend when he was over a couple days ago, I was really appreciating it, but now I'm just, fuck, Haikyuu's good. Haikyuu's really good. I forgot how good it is. And I was really impressed with the production quality in general. It's solid as a rock.
Oh yeah. It's always
a really
been
shiny
such
rock.
A, yeah. It's always been like a super strong production.
Yeah. Season 1 was good, but season 2 and 3, oh boy.
Oh, nice.
It's good stuff. Anyway, that's all I have to say.
I should continue further than, like, the first 2 episodes.
Of the first season?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah, it's definitely
it like
better binge-watched.
Yeah.
It's very easy to watch, but that's not...
Mm-hmm.
That's not a bad thing. Or, that's
yeah,
not...
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
It sounds like something I'd absolutely love.
Yeah, I think you would. It's
yeah,
the perfect mix between relaxing and exciting.
Mm.
That's what makes it so easy to watch.
Alright.
EBK Euphonium.
It's your time, Jonas.
Yeah, so this show is kind of the best thing to have ever existed. Yeah, I think it's not exactly a secret that I love UFO a lot. And,
staple food.
Season... Mm-hmm.
It's your staple food.
Yeah, it sure is. That is still one of my favourite Twitter names I've ever had, to be honest. I don't think season 2, to me personally, lives up to season 1 entirely, but that is to a huge extent due to the point that I've seen season 1 like 5 times now. And that season 2 hasn't had a lot of time for me to like kind of really take fruit in my mind, I guess. I think I will grow to love season 2 just as much as season 1 over the time. And honestly, like, while watching it, season 2 has been absolutely incredible still.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's such an incredibly strong piece. I personally like the first half better than the second half.
I would agree.
I am a big fan of Yuko. Which doesn't really appear much in the second half. She's like she might actually become my favorite character in UFO at this point.
Oh wow!
Because I'm really reading the book right now, and she's just great. So the first half kind of hit me harder because Yuko and Mizore and Nozomi are really cool. I like them a lot. I actually really like Radio. I don't know. Talking about UFO is hard. I like everything about it.
Yeah, I
there's
find
nothing
that
I don't like about it.
When you don't really have problems with the show, it's very hard to pinpoint the important aspects of why you do enjoy it.
It's a lot of it is in the details. UFO is in the details, honestly. It's in itself already a strong show, but like things like the way characters express their emotions, the way the relationships work out over time, everything being like basically foreshadowed in season one, which is not in the book in the slightest, because like the book is added after the second book is added like after the first book got somewhat successful, so there's like no foreshadowing in the book. Every season one has that.
Yeah.
Season one has that, and that kind of carrying over. And I don't know what I'm saying.
Say something then.
All right, good. It's probably better.
I very much liked this season one. I gave it an 8. But part of that was out of respect. Mm-hmm. But with season two, it's not just respect, it's admiration. Like, this show has given me so much more than I ever expected from it. Mm-hmm. It's given me so many more emotions than I expected.
Yeah,
It's reminded me why I love film so much.
Mm-hmm.
It's such quality.
That's
so good.
That's what the first season did to me the first time around. Because like, I watched UFO and I watched Shirobako right afterwards, which is like the best fucking decision I've ever made.
Yeah.
And it was really those two that even actually made me realize that I'm somewhat passionate about things, which is something I never really realized before. So UFO is kind of like that quote-unquote eye-opening, as much as cheesy as that fucking sounds.
I know exactly what you mean.
So season two is... The thing about season two is that it's not just more of UFO. It's a very different show from the first season, actually.
Yes, it is.
What I believe. It's a very different show in with the same characters that feels very similar. If that makes any sense. Because like,
it feels similar, but definitely different.
Yeah. It's
It focuses more on the individual relationships and characters, I guess.
I think the only problem I really have with UFO, and this is really just something that becomes apparent in season two, is that it feels like characters have their important piece and then just fall back completely.
Okay,
like how
in
season two, the first half, like for a lot of season two, Reyna isn't nearly as important.
No, she's like barely in it.
Yeah, or how like every part that Mizora isn't the main focus in, she really falls into the background. Same with Yuko.
Uh-huh.
And that is something that I don't actually like as much personally, which isn't a huge complaint.
Fair.
It's not a huge complaint in the slightest. But it's something that I kind of wish wasn't the case.
I think I didn't notice that because there are just so many characters that I love to watch.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely same. I only noticed it like once someone pointed it out and like said, okay, yeah, that is something that I don't
like. True.
But it's just UFO still has so much to offer in both in the things it talks about and the things it does and the way it portrays emotion and the way it does basically everything it does. As I said, I don't know what I'm talking about anymore. I'm basically just trying to somehow convey that I love UFO a lot.
Yeah, it's Q any other best.
Absolutely. I couldn't do this. It's the same for Kono Kadachi with me. I couldn't tell you what exactly it is about this, because there's so many things. I need to rewatch UFO 2 a bunch of times probably before I can properly talk about it.
Yeah.
Does that mean it's my turn?
I hate to say yes.
I'll let you go.
Alright. EBK Euphonium Season 2. I think the girls are cute.
Me too.
I don't care too much for the drama.
Especially Kimiko and Yuko.
Drama wasn't doing it too much for me. Like you said, Corey, I feel like the characters had their arc and then just kind of fell away. I feel like the tonal change between these switches is a little bit for me, because whenever you see Kumiko talking to Reyna, like, it's almost as if like their personalities change to the point where like it's a very noticeable paradigm shift that happens. And then when Kumiko talks to like her friends, it's just like there's a good and a bad thing to it, because like you can see where the fact Kumiko and Reyna have this sort of deep connection to each other that allows them to, you know, throw away any kind of facade they have on them and just communicate as, you know, two beings. But then I feel like it's, and then, yeah, you see Kumiko, she almost sort of puts on the facade when she communicates with other people to an extent that doesn't exist there with Reyna. But then it becomes too noticeable for me, to the point where like it's I sort of started to lose like the immersion aspect of it, to where like it was just too noticeable for me when things changed, as well as
yes, that's fair enough. It's for me just I very much see that as like Kumiko as a whole. That is very much Kumiko to me, because Kumiko is a character that will 100% use a facade for absolutely everything. And the only time she really lets that down is when she's with Reyna, and towards the end, towards Asuka.
Yeah.
Otherwise, she will always be like, and her sister, I guess. Otherwise, Kumiko is very, I'm not sure if insecure is the best word for this. Insecure in the sense of she doesn't want others to know how she feels, I guess.
Yeah.
She doesn't like exposing herself in a way. I'm not sure how much sense this makes right now. This is like completely out of my ass, but
yeah, like with
I know roughly what
with Kumiko, I felt like like this is quite near just a personal thing for me, but I felt like her actual like intellect changed when she communicated with different people compared to Reyna.
Okay, but that's more understandable. I like, can't think of what you mean, like, but if you notice
like
that,
it's hard to put it in words. But like when she talks to Reyna, it becomes like really deep and intellectual all of a sudden. The point where this is like, wow, these are high school kids, Jesus.
I guess Reyna's very serious.
Yeah. But like the biggest draw for the series for me was Reyna and Kumiko interaction. And when that wasn't happening, I really just didn't care about much any of the other characters. That's just a personal taste for me, but yeah. Other than that, Hibike Euphonium had cute girls. I didn't care too much for the drama. A lot of it kind of felt, I'm going to use that word again, contrived. let's see. It's hard to put it in perspective because I know how much you guys like it. I don't want to like just sit here and shit all over it.
I do want to hear your thoughts.
But, like, I think, yeah, the biggest con I had was just, it just wasn't for me, you know?
Didn't connect with it.
Yeah, I think, another thing, the music. Like, for a show that's almost entirely based on high school band, like, it didn't explore any of it on like any level other than like a superficial level.
It was used as
it was merely used
rather than a focus.
Pretty much. It was used as a way to like show emotion.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Whereas like
music, it's kind of like it does, I feel like anime does that like so much. Like basically anime does that, where it's music is in a way just a way to explore an idea. But like, not just anime, really. Pretty much every medium, I think, does that. Just where, like, a certain aspect of the show is pretty much not. It's pretty much just mainly a way to explore something. So I don't really mind that personally.
But, like, for me, like, I don't know. After watching shows like Beck and Nodame Cantabile, you really notice it a lot more. Because for Hibike, it's very much obvious that they don't explore any kind of like musical theory and it's in the entirety of it. And that it's basically just for Hibike, it could have been it didn't have to be music. It could have been something else. Whether it was like some other form of art. Like it didn't have to be music. It just so happened that music worked well with Hibike. And it's merely a personal preference. I would have just liked to see more focus on the music.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine.
And then the only other thing I had was that I feel like the overall plot became a little formulaic, where like you have like the build up to each new competition. And it's almost a nitpick for me. Like I felt like they could have formulated the plot into a more like fluid motion instead of just having build up competition and build up and then competition.
Yeah, I think that's kind of the downside to how the books work, I guess, because like every book is focused on like the start of after the competition to the next competition. So I agree with it though. That is a good point. It's just kind of like something that comes with the adaptation structure, I guess.
Yeah.
That they chose. But yeah. Should we go into 3 hours then?
Yeah, other than that, I just don't... It may seem really like shallow of me, but if this was based in like a different setting, I probably would have liked it a lot more. And like especially if there was fantasy element.
Okay, fair enough.
Yep. Let's see. I'll start off with the 3 R's. Hibike Euphonium. Like as a whole, I'd probably give it an 8.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
I didn't expect that.
Well, yeah. Like I didn't mention, but like, yeah, this. Like as a whole, it was a good anime. It was decently interesting. It wasn't for me. Recommend it. I wouldn't recommend it to my best friend because
you'd be selective.
I'd be selective in who I recommended it to because for people who like, I don't want to say who are just getting into anime, but I want to say like for people who want like the exciting part of anime, like action. Like action and adventure, like that's not an anime for you. It is a slice of life with character drama.
Drama. Rewatch?
No. Probably not.
Okay, I guess I'll go. I gave it a 9. It's a good show. I will probably rewatch it for various reasons, and I wouldn't recommend it to everyone, but there are a lot. I don't know why I made this such a long thing. Yeah, I'd recommend it to some people.
Someone's vacuuming outside of my room right now.
Oh, I wonder what that was. It sounds like a fish tank.
So yeah, sorry, Niall. It should be all relatively obvious. So it stopped just for me talking about your phone, Glad. Never mind. I mean, this should be relatively obvious. I give it a 10 out of 10. If I could give it 11, I'd give it 11. If I could give it 12, I'd give it 12. I don't care. The highest I can give it. Recommend. I don't think that everyone will love you, though, but I would. I would recommend it to almost everyone I know because I love it too much to not recommend it. For a rewatch, yeah, I mean, I will probably rewatch it at least 3 more times. If I don't, I'd honestly be rather surprised. So yeah, Evo. It's good.
Good shit.
Okay.
Very good shit.
Next up.
Hey, Joe.
I just want to mention I will finish Iron-Blooded Orphans and I will have something to say about it at that point in time. fuck Long Riders.
KJ, right?
We've got Wixos if you want to say anything about it.
What about KJ?
Sure.
Alright. Cause have you watched any of it?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, because like I think KJ's a really interesting show, in a way. It's I think it's kind of what a lot of it's really fun. I had a lot of fun when I was watching it, although I only watched like 2 episodes of it. And then just didn't continue really. But I think a lot of people kind of I hate saying it that way, but I feel like a lot of people misunderstand where the fun in KJ comes from. Because KJ isn't a fun show because it has boobs and butts and people hitting
like,
each other.
Yeah, everyone has like a problem addressing the giant elephant in the room with Keijo. But yeah, it is what it is.
It is
the whole show is just a fan service. But it uses that as its own focus to create an entirely different anime out of it.
Yeah, exactly. Like, looking at KJ, he would expect having fun by looking at boobs and butts, and that's it. But I think a lot of its fun actually comes from the idea of absurdity. In a way, kind of comparable to how Mugyoga used absurdity in its as a comedic aspect, KJ uses it to kind of make things more exciting, I guess, and actually really be incredibly fun. It's Yoga was hilarious because of it. Keijo is more so just incredibly entertaining to watch because of how weird and wacky it is, I guess.
Kyle is so mad right now.
Am I?
Why?
Oh, never mind.
Mayoga. Mayoga is shit.
No, I meant because like Harry keeps using it, but
oh, I mean, like
it's fine.
It's fair enough. Like
you all know, you can't escape Mayoga. I have to mention Mayoga every time I'm.
Oh no, it happened again.
Without explaining why Mayoga is shit, Keijo has some pretty sexy girls in it. TBH, fam.
Nah.
Like you can meh, but
Yuffo is better.
Yeah. Well, Yuffo isn't sexy. Yuffo's cute.
Would have been better with fan service.
Which by definition is probably better.
Actually, some parts aren't only cute. Very rare, but yeah. Anyway, sorry.
I'm a butt guy, so Keijo connects with me on a more intellectual level, more like a primal level. The deepness that these girls thrust their asses in action brings about a primal sense of fulfillment to me that not many other anime can usually satisfy.
Not many other. What other ones do?
I can list a few, but Keijo as a whole was fun. It was fun to watch. You know, like how is this girl going to use her assets to knock this other girl into a glistening pool of water? And yeah, like to talk about the negative aspects of Keijo, yeah, like each character is pretty much a cookie cutter character from a sports anime, and it's sports anime and or like not harem, but just like stereotypical girl characters in anime. But like that's merely a nitpick in my case, because Keijo is about
it kind of fits the show.
Keijo is about using butts and boobs for action.
The show is ridiculous, so like having the characters be ridiculous
there's
as well.
No, there's no really deep or overall underlying message or tone to the series. It's just butts and boobs and action.
It's meant to be crazy and stupid and fun.
It's like Haikyuu, but with butts and boobs.
I think Haikyuu's a bit more than just that.
It didn't have to be volleyballs.
I think the only thing, like, this isn't the thing that Keijo probably wanted to address, like, specifically, but I think the only thing that's interesting about Wycross and about why Wycross about Keijo in that sense is that I think it kind of poses the weird question of fan service or actual narrative use of sexuality. Like, this is obviously not narrative use of sexuality in the sense of
Kill la Kill is
very different, because Kill la Kill actually kind of explores it. Keijo just uses it for the sake of, like, being fun. Is that still fan service or what? And I think that's a kind of an interesting question that Keijo poses, but I don't think
you can, like, deepify it like that, though. Because Keijo is completely fan service.
I don't think it's overly intentional, but...
It's not intentional, but I think that's an interesting question that's being posed by Keijo. It's kind of like similar to how Jaeger pushed the question of how to treat criticism.
Like, I don't think Keijo itself poses that question more than it spurs the question.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
There we go.
Okay. Yeah, Keijo in itself is just boobs and butts, man.
Like, yeah. I'm not sure if I'll actually ever finish it, but it was fun. Did you guys finish it?
I finished it.
So, okay then. 3 hours, I guess.
It had its ups and downs. I had fun. Sometimes I was pretty bored, to be honest. Sometimes it got too stupid for me.
Basically, like, the boring parts were when they weren't wrestling. Then it was just kind of boring. Or no, like, not the only non-boring parts of non-wrestling is the ass toucher. You know what I'm talking about? The gate of booty lawn.
Gate of booty lawn girl.
Like, the girl who could, like, feel a girl's ass and just, like, steal all her moves right then and there.
What a god.
That was the only, like, non-sports fun I had with the show.
There were a lot of superpowers.
It's with my 3 hours, I'll give it a 7. I recommend it to a lot of, like, people, just because it's an absurd and fun show. Like, not even to finish the series, it's fun to just, like, show someone an episode of Keijo. I mean, like, yeah, this is what Japan did this year. Guess what they did? Let's see, rewatch.
Someone that I met. Sorry, I'll wait.
Rewatch, I guess, whenever I show someone an episode, I guess that counts. Not on my own, though. I mean, I could just go watch hentai if I wanted to a greater effect. Go ahead, Jared.
Oh, yeah. Someone that I met on New Year's Eve, and New Year's, I guess, had actually seen at least one episode, I think, which was kind of weird. That's the end of the story. I give Keijo a 6, I believe. Maybe stretched to a 7, but it was... I had fun with it. And I know a lot of people who did. A lot of my friends had a lot of fun with it. So I'd absolutely recommend it to a lot of people. I probably wouldn't rewatch it.
Alright.
Let's see. Next up we've got Maho Shoujo Ikusei Keikaku.
Or Magical Girl Raising Projects.
This show makes
I really
me
don't
sad.
I like let's just breeze through this one.
Yeah, let's do it quick.
Honestly, if you want my opinion on it, just go watch the First Impression podcast we did.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
Because like it's 100% the same. It's a show that I think has some interesting ideas that interest me a lot, but that never does anything with them. And that just goes into a direction that I didn't want to go into, didn't want it to go into at all, and that's why I just dropped it after the first episode.
Yeah, it's very much your basic battle royale anime.
Yeah.
Just tinted moe.
I wish it wasn't. I really just wish it wasn't. I think it has...
Sorry, go.
I was just saying, I think it has like some interest. Some of the things it does in the first episode are so interesting, but it just doesn't really do much with them. Like,
yeah.
And goes into like a direction that completely, I guess, in a way, goes against what I want it to do.
Like, it's so very much battle royale, even to the point of like, you've got the MC who just wants it all to end and everyone to get along. You've got the antagonist who just wants to win. And then you've got everything in between. But just tinted moe. It's just battle royale moe version.
I actually managed to finish it. Because I had a couple of friends who really liked it.
Donnie?
But he's one of them. I just could not find why they liked it. It's just...
Maybe they haven't seen Battle Royale. They haven't seen Battle Royale yet, or read it.
I think it's just that they like that kind of stuff so much. That's just their kind of thing. But for me, that wasn't enough. That wasn't enough to keep me interested.
Yeah.
There were very few nice moments every now and again, but overall...
I think the best part of Mahoiku for me was... The gender bending guy.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Best part.
That is what I mean.
It was interesting.
That's pretty much what I mean by like they had interesting ideas but never really did much with it. Because like that's the part that I wanted them to explore. Because like obviously that's a topic that really interests me. But it just never really. It's kind of moved into a direction that displeases me so much.
That itself could be the basis for an entirely different show.
Absolutely. Like
how do you go about dating a guy who has to turn into a magical girl to fight crime?
I mean, not only that, but in general, just like...
I mean, yeah, just like
it's,
the...
It's one of them...
How do you live with that? Mm-hmm.
One of the main reasons I like gender bending manga so much, I've been reading a shit ton of it lately, is because, like, it's inevitable to go into that kind of question. I think that's really interesting. That's kind of what I want more shows to do, but none of them is doing it. Yeah.
So Jared, give us your 3 R's, man.
First of all, I just want to say something.
Okay.
There's a character called Hardcore Alice.
That's a nice name.
That's all I want to say. I gave Mahoiku, can't really remember. I don't know, maybe like a 4-ish, probably. I don't remember very much. It didn't leave much of an impression on me. Very selectively recommend, but I would probably go to other things much sooner than I would to this. And I would not rewatch it.
Okay. Cool. All
right.
Next. I also just want to say I will watch the 5th season of Natsume Yujin Jo, and I will have probably something to say about it eventually. Next up, Cultic 9.
Oh, Cultic 9.
I've heard really, I heard the show is really bad, but everything looks really good. It's pretty much all I know about it.
With Cultic 9, the ratings are just all over the place. You're either going to like it or not like it.
I have a very weird... A relationship feels too strong. I have very weird feelings about this show. I didn't really care for the plot much. But I really kind of liked it as a whole. I was gonna try and avoid using these words. But honestly, I think they're really important. The biggest reasons, and the main reasons, why I enjoyed Occultic 9 is one, the production. The production quality. And two, which is very much related, the direction. It's such a... Ignoring the story, for the most part, it's such a well-made show. It blows my mind at points. I was somewhat interested to begin with, but a little bit disconnected, apathetic. But eventually, I really bought into it, and I really started to enjoy it. There were, like, as you say, you heard so many people say, it just looks so good. The photography was kind of weird at points, with the line art and stuff. But other than that, like, the backgrounds, the music, the layouts. Actually, the music, that OST is incredible. I listened to it 10-15 times in the first few days I found it. It's one of my favorites of the year. Character animation. At the very least, it's solid. Oftentimes, it's brilliant. It's such a weirdly charismatic show. It's so fast-paced that even if things would normally get boring, the visuals, or even the music at some points, just keep you watching and keep you going. I've never been quite pulled along by visuals before for something that I wouldn't have really cared about otherwise. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why I've had such a hard time stating my thoughts on it. Because I've been trying this for weeks. And it's hard. I'm not sure what else I can say.
Yeah, it seems like a show that was really out there, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
To, like,
I just want to say, those are the biggest titties I have fucking seen in a long
absolutely.
Time. In an anime. The best thing is, in an anime that is not a hentai, those are the biggest tits I've seen in a long time.
They were painful to start with to watch, just imagining it, but I got used to them
quickly. I think that's a joke.
I think
because like there's
it's just such an over the top story.
That is like it's the Keijuu part of this fucking show. There's no girl with like big breasts that big naturally.
All right, shall we do 3 hours and then move on?
Okay,
because we need to be somewhat on the move so we can actually finish this.
Yeah, let's go. I actually give it an 8. I would, to anybody who's interested in production, absolutely recommend it. It's fantastic looking. Actually, I'd recommend it to more people than that, but I'm not quite sure how to describe it, and we need to move on. So, rewatch, quite possibly, especially specific parts. I might even write about a certain part or part of an episode or something that interested me.
Okay.
So yeah.
Next up, we've got Shumatsu no Izeta. I'll start off with I had a lot of high hopes for this series.
I really liked the first episode.
The concept of having a World War II era witch that rides a giant anti-material rifle instead of a broom was such a cool concept to me.
It's pretty
and then,
badass.
Like, and the show's just kind of, it's just mediocre, really. Like, it's kind of unoriginal in how it goes about itself. Really nothing more to say. Izeta is really cute.
To go off what you said, Izeta is so mediocre that I forgot I hadn't even finished it. I literally forgot until you said the name. So, It's so boring.
Can we agree? Can we agree that the concept was like top notch?
Kind of. I as I said, I liked the first episode quite a bit.
All right.
I like this. I like the start. Like what I've seen of, I didn't actually dislike.
And Izetta is cute.
Oh yeah, definitely. It's more for me that afterwards it never really turned into anything that I was really interested enough in to continue watching. Like I watched the first two episodes, but like for once I heard what people were saying about like the part afterwards, and also I just wasn't really interested enough to check it out either way. Like it hadn't really won me over yet, and I heard negative things about it, so I was like, okay, I'm not gonna bother with this. I have so much other stuff to watch right now.
I do want to finish it because like spoilers, there is another witch that pops up.
Mm-hmm.
But
and it fucking sucks.
She's kinda cute, dude.
There's one thing I like about Izetta. Well, about its story. The idea of higher powered beings messing with the wars and battles of those below them.
I can see that. Yeah, that's actually an interesting concept. I like that as well.
But they didn't explore it very well.
Yeah.
Which was a shame.
Mm. Shall we move on to better shows then?
I just want to say, Stella Namaho, I'm just tired of seeing shit like that. Stop it. Stop giving me like
it's fine
mediocre moe shit. Stop it. Okay.
I don't mind about it. I don't really watch it anyway.
Speaking of mediocre moe shit, scorching ping pong girls is far from that.
Shaknetsu no Takimusume. I did not finish it.
It's good. It's good. Yeah, I really liked it. It's like I was really surprised by how much I liked it, because like I started watching Scorching Ping Pong Girls whenever people were already really, really hyped about it. So like I think I remember it was episode 11 or so. It was like 12.
Oh okay.
Was out already, and then like that's when I started it. And I admittedly didn't like it at the start. I think like just the first few episodes are. Yeah, I think the first few episodes are very weak. Outside of a few scenes. I think like it starts off on a very comedic note, but with comedy that I generally don't have a big liking for. And I think that comedy kind of stays during the entire run, but it gets less and less over the time. And what's more important is like more focus on Aguri and Hoyori, I think is what her name
Hoyori,
is.
Yeah.
And more focus on like the club members individually and their problems and like how they and like who they are, and that's the interesting part of the show, and that's when once they actually start focusing on that, the show actually becomes really good.
Yeah, what interested me to begin with was only Aguri. Like in the first episode or two, that she was my favorite part by far.
Yeah, absolutely same.
But one thing that I mentioned in the podcast before, what's so interesting about these characters isn't... I'm going to kind of go against what you say, slightly.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't necessarily them individually, but their relationship with one other person. There are pairs in the show.
Yeah, that's actually a very good point.
They complement each other fantastically.
Mm-hmm.
I really bring out a lot of character.
I absolutely agree with that. It's kind of like, if I look at any of these characters individually, I don't think any of them actually really hold up to being very, very cool. But like, in pairs is when they really become come to shine. So yeah, I agree. Absolutely. That's...
Okay.
Sorry. I was just surprised. I'm not sure what's the... Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Why were we surprised?
No, it sounded like you want to move on.
Okay, yeah, I'm not sure. Is there anything else you want to say? Because I don't have anything else to say on the show.
Honestly. I want to say some of the moments in the earlier episodes, the first half, while it wasn't all great, there were some surprisingly touching moments. And I think that as a whole, it's a very well-directed show, actually. And that really brought out quite a lot of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's surprising.
Sorry, go.
Okay. It has surprising amounts of like precision to it in terms of direction and all of that stuff. And like I think that is a lot of where the actual emotional core comes from, honestly. Because like especially during the ping pong matches and like not only during the ping pong matches, but it's also the one that episode I think that stuck the most with me is the episode that focuses on Hokuto.
Yes. I remember that very well, actually.
Yeah, that is the episode that by far stuck the most with me, and I think that show, that episode in especially, really shows. That is, it's like kind of where the show's emotional core, I think, comes to fruition the most.
Yeah, so, definitely. All of them.
So yeah,
kind of.
Also, the last episode was amazing.
Oh, it was perfect.
I did not expect like, I was kind of surprised by the final. I'm going to spoil it slightly, like by the final battle, by the final match, ending like one episode early, because I was thinking they'd drag it out a bit more, yeah, and have it like be two episodes, which I wasn't really a big fan of as a whole, but I was also left me wondering what they do for the last episode. I didn't expect it to end this well, honestly.
No, it's...
The last episode was so good.
It was so... heartwarming, so conclusive.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
yeah, absolutely.
Maybe not conclusive, but wrapping up.
Yeah.
Also,
I should mention that the one reason why I ended up watching this show is because I went to Jump Festa, and at Jump Festa they had a giant they had a relatively big ping pong girls booth where you could play ping pong.
Oh, nice.
They played nothing but the opening the entire day. And it was brilliant.
Did they have it on the screen?
So good.
Did they have it on
the screen? Sadly not.
But the opening
itself was so good.
It's a brilliant opening. It has such a good rhythm to it, visually and musically.
Yeah.
Which actually reminds me, this OST is also another of my favorites of the year. It's so perfect for ping pong. It's such high BPM, I guess, at times. It reminds me of Iwasaki Taku.
Oh, yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah.
Anyway, Kyle really wants us to move on. So,
it's one of my favorite shows of the season. It turns into a real sports anime like halfway through, and it's really good at it. Okay.
All right, then Koyaz, I guess.
Okay. Before we get into Yuri and Ice, I just want to say, like, fuck Watashi ga Motete Dosunda. It's the most conceited and pretentious shows I've seen in a long time. All right, Yuri and Ice.
3 hours?
Wait, one second. 3 hours,
yeah.
Go Corey. Jonas.
I gave it a 7 out of 10, thinking with a tendency to go higher over time.
Okay.
I don't think like it was a really fun show, but it hasn't gotten to me to the point where I wanted to give like a really high rating.
Yeah, that's fair.
So yeah. I pretty much recommend it to everyone that enjoys sports anime as long as they can get through their humor. Because the humor is I think where the weakness really lies, the show where that kind of annoyed me the most. As for rewatch, it seems unlikely at the moment.
I actually ended up rating it a 9 because that last episode was so damn good.
Mm-hmm.
Recommends not to everybody, but I think, as you say, if you can get through those first few episodes, if you either like them or can get through them, you will probably like it.
Mm-hmm.
Very hype. And rewatch? Yeah, probably at some point.
Okay.
All right, let's get to the big one of the season. Yuri and Ice.
Yuri and Ice.
I'll start. It was a good show. Animation was kind of wishy-washy throughout.
It was up and down.
Mm-hmm.
It had some incredible highlights.
It had some, it had some like highs, and then like...
quite shocking points.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. OST was really good. OP and ED were good. I really just don't care for the dynamic between Victor and Yuri. Like, it's just not my thing.
I have to admit, I'm somewhat the same. I
can completely understand it.
To me, like, I can understand why people care so much about it, and I'm actually quite happy that it exists. But it's not something that, on a personal level, had any interest in at all.
Definitely a Fujoshi's wet dream.
Yeah, and not only that, I'm happy that we actually get like proper gay.
But a lot of times, like it's
properly,
it gets to the point of being kind of ridiculous. Like where
at points, it actually kind of reminds me of a melodrama romance.
Yeah,
in a way, yes, yeah. To me, Yuri on Ice as a show was never, it was always to a big part about like queerness, but it was also the part that that interested me more personally is Yuri's journey.
Yeah.
To growing confident in himself, and Yuri's journey to kind of like finding himself. Similar. That's why I compared it to Flip Flappers earlier, because I think in that sense, like in both of those senses, it's very much. They're very similar in what they do, what they try to do thematically, I guess.
Yeah.
Also, Yurio is the fucking best. I love him.
Yeah.
I think my favorite character will always be King JJ. JJ.
Yeah.
I really hated JJ up until last time.
His last performance was the best part of the show. Cute. Like, that was the best part of the show where, like, JJ realizes that, you know, he's only a human. And that he can feel pressure too. And then, and like where the last part where he screams like, Makenai! Like, I'm not going to lose. And then just kind of still kind of fails. That's the best part.
Yeah.
Plus, best song in the show is his JJ's theme song.
I actually really like the free song for Yuri.
Yes.
That one is... I love that one.
Wait, is that...
The second one he danced to?
It's the piano one. It's the one also, he had his friend,
is
right?
Yuri on Ice.
Also, Yurio's Agape? Is it Agape?
Yeah,
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, I love that one as well. But yeah.
Those are my two... Actually, those are my three favorite.
The one thing that kind of... I mean, I don't know if it was like intentional or not, but they kind of just really brushed past the part where like they explained that Yuri had that unfinished song that his friend in college wrote, and then it was just like next episode, oh, my friend finished it,
oh, we contacted her,
yeah,
like she that made, was she remade it,
they like they really that, just but... like swept that. I mean, like, I yeah, it wasn't part of the plot, but like there was literally no other context other than, oh yeah, I called her and she finished it.
Yeah, I think...
I'm not sure why she understands him so much.
That's a good question. The thing is, like, I think that scene in itself is actually... It's a bit sudden, yeah, I agree with that. But I think a lot of it is relatively important in the sense that... Yuri growing the confidence to do something like that is already something already. I think that's... I understand why it's there, but I agree that, like, it's a bit sudden and a bit weird. But yeah, one of the... biggest gripes I honestly have with the show is how much it brushes over characters. And it's...
I was amazed, like, by how much time they spent on the ice.
Yeah, I was amazed as well. Like,
that
kind of
ties in,
I think. I love the fact that they do that.
Yeah.
I think it's a really good thing. But in its ambition... like, that makes it, one for once, a really ambitious show. But in that ambition... it already also kind of sets up its own failure in a way.
Exactly.
Because it's... I wish the show had like two or three more episodes to explore these characters and like add more thematic depth to it. Because like it felt empty in some parts.
Yeah, like, to expand on that, I feel like, yeah, it definitely lost focus in parts. I would have definitely liked to see either, well, not either, but I would have liked to see more focus on the ice and Yuri's like ascension, basically. Because to me, I feel like the whole Yuri Victor thing just kind of drew away from the show. It drew away like the from the fact of Yuri's growth by saying like,
I don't think
I liked it. I don't for think, that. I think it added to
I
it.
Don't. Yeah, I think it added as well. I don't. I actually, as I said, I'm happy it exists, and I think it just aided the show. It just had no personal investment in the relationship itself. It's more for me that I wish side characters would have had the chance to grow. Like, they have the chance to grow, but in a way that feels really unnatural, I guess, outside of JJ. JJ is like, the reason why I like JJ best out of all the side characters is because he's the only one who feels like, where it feels like he has natural growth, in a way. Everything else feels, for lack of a better word, I hate this word, but forced. It feels like it's, I'm missing words right now, but I feel like they didn't have the time to really grow into them, into their own character. They exist as this one thing of like, okay, this is how this character is, and now he's suddenly different. Like, that's how it felt to me.
They kind of have added too many characters.
I could see why they dived
into all of them instead of focusing.
Exactly, and I can see why they would do that, but I don't think it works well. I want the show to have like two or three more episodes, maybe in an OVA or whatnot, to kind of like. I think it's frenetic. I think it's in the second season. It's too late.
I mean, I'm pretty sure it's getting one anyway.
if it could very well, yeah. I would be happy with one with another season. To be honest, a sports anime like this, I'm really happy to see getting more seasons, because like I think sports anime. Like, later stages is where sports anime oftentimes get even better and better and better. Sports anime specifically.
I do want to mention...
Look at something like Hajime no Ippo or Baby Steps.
I do want to mention, like, my mom was, like, the very first... She was very, very quick to point out the elephant in the room for this anime. Because I showed her the first episode, and I mentioned at the end that, like, yeah, there's a lot of gay undertones in this... in the first few episodes, she's like, undertones, honey, they're gay. They're completely gay. I was like, yeah, you know, you're right, mom. They're just gay.
Very honest.
When you say it like it's a bad thing. I'm honestly happy to say it. I'm happy like Yuri on Ice exists, honestly. I think it's a really good show.
Yeah.
And I think it addresses really important points. And I think, I want another season, but I want that season to have more time. And I want them to be able to really... Because, like, as I said, I feel like a lot of Yuri on Ice feels like it's going into a really cool direction, but it feels slightly empty.
It's kind of messy.
And I feel like... Absolutely messy, yeah, but also empty. And I think the empty part is, like, what really made me not love it. I liked the show, but I didn't love it. And had they been able to take all of these side characters and kind of use them to add more thematical depth to what was already doing, yes, I think I would have seriously, absolutely 100% fallen in love with Yuri on Ice. This way, it's a show I really like, but it's not more than that.
I enjoyed it a lot. And I thought Yuri as the character was really good.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
His progression was...
Mm-hmm.
That and skating were just my favourite things about it. But yeah. I didn't get much more out of it.
I actually really like the idea of like expressing emotions through ice skating. I think that was a really... Yeah. Like, choosing ice skating for this was the perfect choice, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
There's so much skating.
There is so much skating.
It's crazy.
Let's get these 3 R's down.
What? But Aoni.
We're not going to skip the 3 hours to do Aoni.
Oh, sorry. I'm really tired. It's 10 a.m. I haven't gone to sleep.
I was about to say, 10 a.m. isn't late, isn't early, but...
All right.
You haven't slept. <Let's>
see.
All right. 3 hours. 10 hours. 3 hours.
You're nice. I give it a 7. I'd recommend it to people who like ice skating and also gay people.
yeah, that makes sense.
I think that should be everyone, to be honest.
I don't think everyone should be gay, though.
Yeah, everyone should like
gay. Well, I mean, like, that's a whole different thing.
Neutrally, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I'd recommend it to someone who wants like an, you know, a rise to the top kind of anime. Rewatch? Probably not. No. Yeah, I'm not going to rewatch it.
All right, I'm going to go next then. I'm going to give it an 8 out of 10. Yeah, again, reasons I just pointed out. Recommend? Absolutely. I think it's an important show. I think it's a good show. I don't think... I mean, obviously, I wouldn't recommend it to everyone, but I think the majority of people, especially those of you who are interested in, like, the things it explores, confidence, queerness, etc., finding yourself, those kind of things. If you enjoy sports anime, and this is a show you should definitely be looking out for. Rewatch, potentially. I'm not sure yet.
I also gave it an 8. Recommend? I have nothing to add. Rewatch? Possibly. I think definitely specific scenes or sequences, skate sequences. Absolutely. Yeah, I'm not sure about full series. Possibly.
Cool. Let's take just 1 minute and go over Aoni. Like, Japan, what?
Aoni,
like, what? Like, Japan, what possessed you to take my, like, mystery horror game and turn it into some kind of crazy comedy? Like, I'm not jacking on it. It was a good show. Entertaining, but, like, what the fuck?
It's a surprisingly good show. Because they're always killed by the monsters in the end. But there's actually one episode where it's from the monster's perspective.
Isn't that like the last
episode? Which is kind of funny. Oh, wow. It's like, no, I was thinking of one like in the middle. It's his daily, it's their daily routine. And it's kind of funny.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a good show. They're like 3 minutes long. So I absolutely recommend
it. Oh, shit.
You know what else you should watch? TQ.
Yes. GQ's probably.
I just totally forgot. We haven't even talked about To Be Hero.
Oh shit. Oh, fuck. God.
All right. Let's take 5 minutes and just go over it. To Be Hero is a wonderful show. I loved it. Like at first I was fine with it just being, you know, a crude comedy, which is what it was. But then it was so touching at the end because, like, it took that crude comedy and it was like, yeah, this is actually really touching. All that crude stuff.
It's we're gonna like twisted it in a way that made it
not. It made
almost justifiable.
It was so touching at the end. I even teared up at the end. It's just such a good show for what they had to work with. The animation was really good. Like it wasn't like a ufotable production, but like they just like, you know, how like with Konosuba is not near the greatest animated flick, but they do with what they have and they do it really well.
I think Konosuba was actually animated really well.
It's animated well. At times really well, but in generally just well, I think.
Alright.
Yeah, To Be Hero's conclusion was surprising in a very good way.
3 hours.
It was a twist that I really like as a general thing idea. Sorry, I'm tired.
I give To Be Hero a 9 out of 10. Only because it really surprised me in the end. Because I was going to give it a 7 out of 10 just because, like, it was a really good crude comedy. But then it was just turned into a really touching piece at the end. Recommend it. I'd recommend it to anyone, to be honest. Unless, like, you hate life or don't like comedy. Rewatch? Maybe. Jared?
I'd give it, I don't know if it's six or seven. It's a tough one to decide whether to recommend. You'd have to look at the person and think really hard about them. Or tell them to watch one episode.
Well, if like the person doesn't like crude comedy, then or like if it's the person that you look at them and that like they don't take jokes, yeah, not for them.
Probably not rewatch.
Okay. And on a side note, Kitaro Shonen, 7 out of 10. I'd recommend it to people who like really cute girls, and I will probably not rewatch it.
It's a cute short. It's just a few minutes long per episode. It's a bit weird, but it's kind of charming. I think I give it maybe a 6 out of 10. Recommend it as just a nice casual short. And probably not rewatch it. I'd watch more if there was like another season, though.
All right. Is anyone else?
I did finish Cheating Craft.
Oh, you finished Cheating Craft.
I'm just gonna read my notes because it's gonna be easier. Kind of. There were a few good jokes. The first episode was just bonkers as fuck. And that was great. But after that, it got a bit less so and kind of just silly in weird ways. It's definitely not a slow-paced show, and they were half-length episodes, 12 minutes. But I think it would have actually benefited from being a bit faster. It was pretty fun overall. It had some good moments, but I think they're a bit too spread out to really make it stand out very much. So for that reason, I don't think I'd recommend it to really anybody. Give it maybe a 5 out of 10.
Okay.
And not rewatch it.
Cool.
Not a bad show, though.
Does anyone have any other shows?
No. Ping Pong Girls is really good, though.
Cute girls are good.
That's true.
Okay, well, I'm sorry we had to wrap that up quickly at the end, but...
We still have one thing left to do.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no.
Oh, man.
It's time. I'm sorry, Kyle. How long do you have?
I have, like, a minute.
Okay.
Okay, Kyle, what do you support? What do you
okay,
want?
Okay, Flip-Flappers.
Animated season.
Or I don't care. Either Flip-Flappers, Fune wa Amu, or To Be Hero for anime of the season.
All right. Okay. Jared, would you support me and Ufo?
Yes.
All right, Hibike Euphonium, good. Anime of the season.
That was quite a cop out,
but thank you for joining us for Anime Abroad Podcast.
This isn't how it's meant to be.
I'm your host, Kyle, and I'm sure we'll have fun the next episode. If you like this episode, please give us a like. Comment if you have any feelings or wanting questions, and please consider supporting our Patreon. Our editor would be very much appreciated. I guess that's about it. I'll see you guys later.
I guess that happened.
We're supposed to scream at each other and everything.
You feel is good. Goodbye.
You feel is overrated. Goodbye.